Joining us on INSEAD Knowledge from the INSEAD Leadership Summit Middle East in Abu Dhabi is Olivier Giscard d'Estaing. He's one of the distinguished founders of INSEAD, and he's also the author of a new book, Le Réveil du Peuple. The book looks forward to 2025 to 2075. And to me, it seemed a little bit almost like science fiction. You imagine a lot of different scenarios. What were the four themes that you focused on in the book? You had four different periods.
Yes, you see, I first thought to remind what happened in the last century, because I think many forces emerged that are now having a main influence on our world. But then I said it's more important to forecast what's going to happen, because there are some trends you can extrapolate, but there are new things that will happen. Because the world is made by three groups of people. The scientists, who are bringing so new inventions, improvement, that it changed our life. The second actors are the business community. And if you look at globalization, which is really the new happening in this century, it comes from business activities. The spread of their product, of their investments, of their research and developments. And they made a new world in a way. And the third is the rule of government and the trend of versus nationalism versus mondialism. I lived that because in my youth it was the war between Germany and France that has affected us most of our youth, my youth. And in 1944, when I was visiting Hamburg, Frankfurt, Munich, completely destroyed, we young people said, let's change all of that. We made our own revolution. And I went to see young German people and I said, let's be friends, which was very surprising at the time. So I have this model in mind, and now it's the same level trends that you can extrapolate to a world dimensions, saying the continents with rivalries, in economics, in domination, in culture, in impact. And I say, let's work together for this planet in which we all live. So this shows you the trends, the reason why some of the things are derived from the past, but some others are looking ahead very much to help us to understand how to adjust to these new changes.
So you do talk about having sort of a world union, a little bit like the European Union, but on a world scale. That's one of the end ideas that you come up with. So is this? Do you think this is really going to happen? I mean, clearly you think it needs to happen, but is it going to happen?
Oh, yes. Actually, we call it United World because it's significant. But the idea is world economic and social governance. That's what we need, because we are in a such interdependent way of life between all our continents that we need to have rules and political decisions and directions and leadership at world level. I don't think the United Nations is in a position by their charter to have a political leadership. I think the only one direction we see of this type was the G7. Rich Evans tried to give to seven chief of state a feeling of leadership, of working together. And now they extended it to G20. And the G20, for me, it's part of this world union because they represent 3/4 of the world production, of the wealth, and of the population. So if they get together and agree on some specific issues dealing with economic, social, fiscal affairs, they will have a great impact.
You wrote the book as though you were writing a personal history, but it's a fictitious character. Why did you choose this particular form to send this message across? It's personal.
Probably I was inspired by Jules Verne more than by Nostradamus. You know, Jules Verne is this man who said that we could go around the world in 80 days at this time, that we could go 20,000, 20,000 lieues sous les mers, under the sea,
20,000 leagues under the
that
sea.
We could go to the moon. Mm-hmm. I mean, he predicted all those. And I was inspired in this model because I think we will have happenings like that. When I have seen the revolution in electrical energy. I mean, I waked up with the bombs on Hiroshima one morning and were completely upset and puzzled. And 5 years later, it was producing energy, and now it's producing 80% of our French energy. So it's changed completely the outlook. And things will happen. When you realize the billions we spend on research nowadays, it will bring this type of change. So I said I will make it very lively, like not a theoretical academic approach, where is the world going to be? No, it's going to be very lively. That's why I wanted to do it with an INSEAD graduate who is telling his experience in managing a worldwide company and meeting people all over the world.
You could be writing the story of a future INSEAD graduate.
Exactly, this is the idea.
What would you like people to remember from the book? I mean, it is easy to read. It has it kind of carries you through with the narrative.
Well, there are several messages. One message is my worry about the evolution of democracy. I believe the power lays in the people, but it has to be delegated to other people who know more than common people about world problems. This revolution of the people are bringing some positive changes. You know, the French Revolution has been terrible, but brought some changes probably that our society needed. And what is happening now, it's sort of a world revolution. It's spreading up, spreading over different continents, because people are dissatisfied, and they are dissatisfied for specific reasons of the survivals of poverty and excessive inequalities. So this is the first message is the governments have to listen very carefully to the people. That's to avoid revolutions. The second message is a message of optimism. You know, my faith is in human capacity to innovate and to adjust. If you help them in that direction, they will do tremendous things. So if you project that 50 years ahead of us, it's going to be completely different. Things will be different. And my book is making several scenarios possible. For instance, a decrease of economic growth. What would happen when all the basic needs will be served? Or when the population will start decreasing instead of increasing? My other message is that we should get rid of this nationalistic approach, which, as I say, there is a trend. It's a minority trend, but it could be a violent trend exploited by some powers. And that's dangerous. So we have to react to that by education, by the fact that people are so close together now from all the continents that they can start understanding each other and realizing that no one is going to dominate the other. No religion will dominate the other religions. All of them will survive in their way and expanding some qualities to make the human being a little above his materialistic approach.
Well, thank you very much, Olivier Giscard d'Estaing, for being with us on INSEAD Knowledge.